to three parts. So one is with the IoT, IoT structures, and how can you make simple things like words like IoT. And the second section will be some case studies, which we have implemented here in the lab. So some kind of that will give you some idea that how those things are working. And in the last section, third section, we will discuss some of the emerging research areas, which you can take up for your studies and for your references. So that will be the flow of today's talk, like three things. IoT, let's understand IoT. There are some kind of a confusion between IoT and the structures. And then focus is towards electric vehicle. We take one or two case studies. And then at the end, some ideas or some new areas where people are working. Okay. So I start with a simple description of what is IoT and what are the things. So people define in a way, a very simple way, that is the crude way of understanding that it's Internet of Computing Devices. So that means and those devices have some computing facility in that. So they can collect some kind of data, and then they do some kind of processing there. And then after that, they communicate with each other. That means they transfer the information to each other. So that is basically Internet of Things. And these are of a different nature. So physical devices, many are there, and now they are connected with each other. So that's the meaning of things are there and they are connected. And they are connected on a backbone of a communication system. So that's why the three things connected, that is basically Internet of Things. So when we talk about the devices, we have a lot of things near and around. We don't expect all the time that, they are having some kind of internet connections with the devices. They are having the facility of internet or communication. They may not have, but some may have a regular connection. Some may have communication, that is, they transfer the data after some interval. But the important aspect here is they are independent of human access, basically. So it's not manually I'm taking a data and then transferring it to some other port. If I have a pen drive, I take a data from computer and then pass it to another computer. That is nothing. That is not an Internet of Things. Internet of Things means it has to do without or independent of human access. So if we summarize it in a very simple way, it is a transfer of analog signals, which then we convert it into digital also. And then they are connected through the internet to communicate each other. So they transfer the data streaming is there for certain kind of a purpose that we'll see what are the various purposes they are being used in the system, basically. So when we talk about they perform these three things, they are interrelated systems. Means I have one system, it has certain relation with something else, or system A depends upon the information received from the system B or something like that. They transfer the data, and they transfer the data over a network. It can be their local network, or it can be some kind of a global network. So there are various topologies of the network. The important part here is your human interactions are not there, and as such, computer interactions are not there. You are transferring the data by some wired connection to a computer, and then the computer is uploading it to a cloud. So there the things are different. It's not like that. And Internet of Things. So these things are basically comes into the picture straightforward. So we need small computing devices. Mechanical machines may be there, which can be used. They are the basically one can say things to be controlled. Then we need a sensor network. basically I have sensor, I measure certain kind of thing. So I have a pressure sensor, it measures the pressure, and then it transfers it to some certain some other unit. So that unit is basically, say, that is another sensor, and then the sensor and both are connected. So they are wireless sensors, topologies and all that. So there is a network between those sensors. And then, yes, very obviously, we need electrical systems to transfer one kind of a signal or one kind of information to the another information. We must have a digital machines. And all these comes, when they combine together, we come out with that terminologies like IoT and all these stuff. Okay, so when we took in a bigger picture, for me, I'll consider there are four things must be there when we talk about the IoT. One is like embedded system, because we need some kind of a small kind of a processing, some kind of a filtering, some kind of conversions and all that. The second is I need a network, basically, because I need to communicate my data from one point to another point. So I must have a network. Without network, I cannot do that. And then third kind is machine learning, which is now it is becoming an integral part. Machine learning, you can say, basic learning mechanism, so that they can infer from it. They can find out, okay, what is the meaning of these signals or this data which they are receiving, and based upon that, they can even take a decision. So machine learning means like it starts from a very basic machine learning. It can be a high computing machine learning algorithms and all that. And then also what we need, real-time analytics, basically. So the analysis we are doing, it's not like like past analysis we are doing. What we do is either we are doing predictive analysis or onboard analysis, that okay, these things are coming, what are the meaning of these data and all these things. So these are the four very recent areas which are very popular nowadays. Because these four areas are popular, they are converges into one technology, and this buzzword comes into the research community, and that is basically IoT. And very obvious, it needs a contribution from all consumer, industry, government, and all these setups. So let's talk about what are the characteristics, what we need if I develop some kind of IoT applications or IoT system. So we need an intelligence. So I have signal, data is there, but what's the meaning of data? How I infer that data, whether it's dangerous or whether it's high or whether it's something else. Some kind of intelligence we need in our calculations to infer the information in those data streams. It has certain kind of architecture, device architecture, and there has to be a network architecture. How big is my network? And then we have to see the complexity of the problem. Because see, if my system is more complex, and if it is taking a lot of time to execute my instructions and all that, then we may lose the real-time applications and all that. So we need to see that, okay, what is the complexity of my system, and that finally comes to also another part, that is what is the size of my network and all these things. So these are the few things which are required, or you can say that they are the characteristics when we design any IoT for any particular application. So it can be like, now when I talk about the architecture, it can be three-stage architecture or it can be a four-stage architecture. So three-stage architecture is basically first three things you can have. You have sensors and actuators, which convert my one form of energy to another form of energy. Then we have internet gateways or data acquisition and data acquisition. So when I convert one form to another form, I have certain kind of data formation, and then that data to be transmitted through wired or independent system to some other platform. So that is basically second thing. And then the pre-processing is required everywhere. So these three are the three stages. And if I add a database system also, like I'm storing the data at a cloud, and then the cloud is doing some kind of calculations independently, and then finally giving some kind of inference from those data. And again, my device is again modified based upon those data. So that is a four-stage IoT structures. Mostly we have three-stage IoT structures, but nowadays, yes, we are more interested in keeping our data so that we can analyze the data that, okay, our data as like what we are receiving, is there any meaningful information in that or not? Okay, so that's basically here. We have the structures. We have a lot of things with us. So we have devices, machines, people, tools, cars, traffic lights, animals, and all these things. These are the things, and which are powered with your sensors or actuator. So this is a media to connect to the things, and then these sensors and then process the things, and they have internet connectivity. That data is pre-processed, and then we have machine analytics or storage of the data. So that is the basically complete architecture of your IoT system, that is Internet of Things. So where we can use it, it is used everywhere nowadays. We have tried in various domains from medical science, agriculture, robotics, and yes, electric vehicle also. So if you think of a domain, so one is the internet, the industrial internet. So nowadays, most of the machines are fully automated. So and not only they are automated, pre-planned automation, but they are basically the automation is nowadays intelligent or learning kind of automation. So they learn according to the requirement of the system. So is the connectivity okay or it's broken? It's like, I need to understand that also.
It is perfect, sir.
Okay. So another application is farming. This one is a very hot nowadays. If I talk about in terms of IoT, not only we are condition monitoring of the soil sample, soil, we are controlling the various parameter of the soil, like its fertility, its moisture, the temperature, so to increase the yield of the crops. Then yes, to check the insects and all these things. So various types of sensors and all these things are placed. So nowadays it's a basically intelligent farming which is coming up. Those who are working in other sectors like greenhouses and all these things, so they are very common there. Then it's a boom area. That's a basically have since last four or five years we are working this one, and I'm sure many of you are using wearables where your watches are there. You go for running and moving and all these things, and after completing your whole exercise, you can see how much calories you have burned, how much kilometer you have covered, and all that stuff is there. Also, your mobile phone has that facility. It will measure the distance covered, calories burned, heartbeat, pressures, and all these things. So these are the good applications of IoT, and they are increasing day by day, especially in healthcare. Then, smart homes. So now we have homes which are, means we have devices that which are basically programmable devices. Yeah, right from our lighting system to only front wheel or all the four wheel or something like that. And that is to be, I mean, it's like it varies from vehicle to vehicle. We need some kind of a converter. You can see here, high voltage to low voltage or low voltage to high voltage. So a lot of cabling and all these things. So these are very interesting areas to work on. So since first picture, when you see the picture, the first thing which strikes to us is the battery. So I'll start with the battery, the work which we have done, and how IoT can be, I mean, it's like how IoT helps there. Because battery management system is a very important area, because you are using so many batteries. So each battery, what is the problem with the battery? It's a chemical system. So no two batteries are same, basically. All the batteries are different. And now you are connected in some kind of a series parallel combinations and all that. So their characteristics are different. Their charging, discharging, everything is different. And you are connected in series and parallel, some kind of a balancing is required. And then the question is how to monitor what is the condition of my battery and all that. So, and at the end, I'll take that one after this slide. And at the end, I need my dashboard like this. That, okay, on my screen, I can have a map, which is nowadays very common. I must have battery information. I must have my consumption information. My whole, this dashboard is connected to my mobile, so where I have all information. Nowadays, this Maruti Nexa series, they have all this information. If you try to find it out, okay, what is your profile, how much time you accelerate, how much time you unnecessarily put your brake, and they even rate you that how good is your driving and all that. So how they are doing it. So those things we can come back to it. We can see that how that IoT helps in not only condition monitoring of my things, but also educate me to drive or use the things more properly. So the first thing is the battery, and the battery is basically check out the batteries. We need a battery management system, and the battery management system looks like this, which is in front of you. And for us, which is the most important part, is this one. This one is basically when I'm doing computing of my cells, basically. So it is connected to various cells in series and parallel combination. So I'm computing my model of the cell, because it's not a good idea that, okay, I have so many cells, and what I'm doing is I'm measuring voltage and current and then try to find out some kind of things. There are some good interesting ways to do that. So I need to understand what is the state of myself, what is the quality of my battery, and how far it goes. So very obviously, at the end, you can see at the dashboard whether it's a charge or not charge, or how much kilometer it can be extended further. All these things are very interesting. So that is battery management system. Means it automatically controls the your balance, your power, in the cells itself. Like I have 3 cells and 1 cell is discharging fast, 2 others are discharging slow. So very obvious, after some time, what will happen, that which is discharging fast, that will die out. And the burden will be then totally on the other 2 cells. So then it will create a pressure, some kind of those 2 cells, and even may deteriorate the life. So it keep on balancing, mean there's some kind of a balancing so that the total in sum, the 3 cells are used optimally. So that's basically the purpose of a battery management system. Some kind of, you can see here, it's just some kind of a structure. You can see all these are the cells. They are packed, they are connected with each other, and then they are monitored in a nice way. This one is a simple example of the same thing which we have discussed. You can see there are three batteries here, and they have battery charger and monitor, and then they are connected. Finally, they are all the processing, how they are being charged and discharged is controlled by the battery management system. So there are sensors which sense few of the things, and they send that information to the battery management system, which take a decision that, okay, which device has to be on or which has to be off, so that the total requirement is fulfilled. At the same time, we have information about the individual batteries, and their life is also improved. you can see here some graphs and all these things. So what is required? Let me explain that part. I'm coming directly to that part. So these are the very common things which are given. So this one is one of the work which we completed last year. This one is complete battery management system. Okay, so in this battery management system, you can see here is a battery pack, which is here. And we have voltage and current temperature and all these things are measured. Now what is required? As an output, I need few things. One, I need what is the state of charge of my battery. The second thing which I need is what is the available power. Third thing which is very important for me is what is the health of my battery. Another one is which is my runtime of my battery. And last one, we are interested in usable capacity, what is the question. So these are the four things which I need. And what is the input is very interesting. Input is basically simple. I have three things which I can measure: voltage. I have voltage here, I have current and the temperature. So I am putting three sensors, which are voltage, current, and temperature, and they are giving me the signal. So first, to model this one, to model this whole structure, to get these four outputs, what I need to find out is this one, the first part. That is, what are the parameters of my battery? Because it's not like fixed for every battery. They are different and they are very varying also, like they are varying with time and temperature and all that. So when we start working on this one, we try to formulate this problem in a very interesting way. So this one is the same. Oh, this one is repeated. Anyway, this one is highlighted to show you that, okay, what is the, because why we need the parameters, that is here. So we need a parameter to estimate my, what is my SOC? So that's why I need a parameters to estimate, and what is my SOH? So, and then how much is the power available to predict that one? So for that, I need my battery parameter. So we started with a very simple, this one is a very simple battery model. And you can see the two parts. So one circuit is an energy balance circuit. We are not much interested in that. We are more interested in the second circuit, which is voltage response circuitry. And you can see there that they are now these R and C combination are basically order. So you have first order model, second order model, third order model. So you keep on connecting your SOH is state of health, basically. SOH state of health. So you keep on adding these RC parallel combinations, and you will find that the order keep on increasing. So this one is taken here, and you can see here are two parts here. This one is fixed resistance, and we have short time transients and we have long time transients. So just to model the battery, basically. So if I have these values of R0, RS, RCS, R1, RC1, I can easily model my battery. Okay, so, but the interesting part here is how to get those things. So let's go for a long time transients. So I'm skipping this one, short time transients. So when I try to write down this equation for long time transients, I need three things. So what is R0 of this battery? What is RC1 and what is R1 and what is C1? So when I write down this equation, you can see the parameter equations. 1, 2, 3 and this one is 4. So you can see here, R0, R1, C1, and VOC, that is open circuit voltage, which is very important. Now, but for this, to simulate it, you can see these A1, A2, A3, and the last number is A31. Now, these are the parameters these are the constants to be calculated. So to execute or to understand these equations, okay, I need these constants. Okay, these are the time constants on all these things. That is not an issue. But I need to get these 31 coefficients, basically, for a particular motor. And every motor is having a different coefficient. So it's a task, difficult task, how to get it done. So that is first thing. And then we go for the equations, output equations. So you can have this one as equation number 5, which is a time-dependent nonlinear terminal voltage equation. So if I know R0, R1, C1, VOC, then what is my terminal voltage? So that is also a nonlinear equation. And then if you go for the charging rate, again, it can be calculated like this. And if you are looking for a state of charge or depth of discharge, basically, SOC and DOD. So for, they are all, again, basically some kind of an summation or integral form of the equation. So if you see these equations, they are highly, they are nonlinear equations, highly nonlinear. Coefficients are very big. And the question is how to find these coefficients, how to model it. So here we try to take the thing in a very different way. What we have done is we have taken one battery and we know the various tests which we can perform on a battery to measure the SOC. So we have instruments which can measure it and we can plot conjunction and all those structures, draw the graph, and we have SOC. But you cannot install those components or those measuring instruments on the board. So what we have done is, we have done in a different way. What we have taken is, from these unknown equations, we assume that, okay, this is my final voltage and this is my experimental voltage. And then we take the difference of this. So this one is known to me. This one is experimentally calculated. And this one is basically from my model. And we just make it an objective function, optimization problem. So we convert this problem, optimization problem, and then, okay, minimize it. So when the minimum appears, then minimum appears only when your experimental value is same as your theoretical value. So at that state, whatever be the value of the coefficients, that will be the value of those A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. Okay, so this one is one thing which is being done. And then since it's a nonlinear complex problem, so we use some optimization techniques to do it. So these are the various optimization techniques you can see here, and you can see the coefficient values of this axis. So there are 34 coefficients. Now this one is for a single battery. Now once this one is known to me, yeah, then the things become simple. And then whatever my sensor is giving me the input, I can easily predict, okay, what is going to be there at now. Because now I know my model parameters. So I know 34 model parameters. And these are the techniques which are being used here to find the optimal value. Okay, so just to show you some of the results, this one is one. You can see here your dot is basically experimental value, and the line which is drawn there, that is basically the measured value. So you can see they are aligned with each other. You can see here, the curve is exactly following the dots. That means, my experimental model and now my theoretical model are same. And please note it, they are at a different temperatures. Okay, so when we have different temperatures, obviously the parameter further increases because now temperature is also affecting these coefficients A0 to A31. If you include your temperature, then the coefficient becomes 44. So you have to optimize 44 coefficients. So we performed it just to model it from the data. So that is basically required. So we can say what we are seeing. Machine learning is somewhere coming in. That is basically a one part to optimize your thing. And again, it has to be done separately. Okay, for charging and discharging coefficients and all that. So we have checked it. Yes, it is working fine for charging here and discharging here and discharging here. The model is perfect. Now I have one model with the coefficients. Okay. And now what is happening that now I'm using that particular battery. So the information is keep on coming to me, which is basically voltage and the uses, your SOC. And it keep on updating my data also. So what is happening with time or with the temperature, there is some change in the parameters. So it automatically incorporate those and then send those data back to the processing unit. So that is one kind of thing. Somebody is making a request. Okay, we will see later on that request. So these are the various graphs basically to give idea that, okay, what will happen if I'm charging at a 0 degree, at a 25 degree, or at a 45 degree, or what I'm, so temperature has its effect on charging and discharging of this. Now this thing, if this thing is known to me, so then I can, okay, I can have this model with me. Once I have this model, then I can go for SOC estimation. So there are various methods like filtering math, Kalman filter, extended Kalman filter, particle Kalman filter, because this one is state estimation. So based upon what states we want to estimate, so these are the very nice filtering techniques which are already established. These are conventional techniques which are already established and given in the literature. So you can use these estimation techniques to estimate the SOC from the from the input from your parameter model. Then you have SOH. So SOH is not a state estimation. Again, what we do in SOH, state of health. So similar battery, same make, same configuration. We have certain kind of experimental results. So here we use some kind of machine learning. I have battery. I can say, okay, state of health is this much. So I have 2-3 parameter points I know. Then I extend those points. Say I have 3 points which are known to me. Okay. And then I extend the fourth one based upon some kind of forecasting technique. And if my fourth is coming same like the, I mean, when I'm using it, then it's okay. Then I extend that particular model further for the next state estimation. If not, then again, I modify it and something like that. So that is basically SOH estimation. And from all these outputs, you can easily find out what is the available power, which is remaining in your battery. Because this one is why this one is very important, your SOH and your parameters and SOC. If I'm missing any of these things, so it is showing that your battery is fully 100% charged. But you will find that after few hours, the total power is gone. So that means I'm missing something, because it is 100% charged, but its a rate of discharge is very fast. So health is poor. So that has to be considered there. And then there are very nice techniques which can be added here after obtaining all these things. Every time it may be there, you may not require these things to estimate your SOC. Like what is there in some phone. It is not some kind of sensors which are keep on measuring the current which is drawn from the battery. How they do it? They do it in a very interesting way. How much time you are using a particular application? That is one, I know that T. And then if I'm using that particular application, then per millisecond or microsecond, how much is power requirement to execute that particular application? And from there, I can find out the total power consumed that by that particular application for time T. And then I subtract it, okay, from the total power, charge power. So I can find out, okay, how much battery is left. So it's some kind of an indirect kind of estimating the battery power in some of the phones. Some of may have very small kind of stuff, sensing system, but that makes the things bulky. Because just you imagine that you are having in your computer, in your mobile, you are having different types of applications and different types of usage things. So if everything is connected with sensor, then it becomes very bulky. Okay, so you just do one test. Like now, if you are using mobile, you just use your Facebook, and then you turn it off, and then you use WhatsApp, turn it off, and then you use some kind of a navigation system. You'll find you can easily observe that how the battery consumption is there. Because if you are using navigation, so you are using app plus your sensing system, because every time your transmitter has to transmit something and it has to receive, so more power consumption is there, something like that. So that is the way to do some kind of estimation. So the same thing can be done here. Now, once I know these four parameters of a single cell, then anything, any big pack, I can easily control or manage that, okay, which has to be used and so that the batteries may not be damaged. Say if you have, again, I come to the same example, if you have three batteries or three different SOCs, so say first is gone and then post stress is on two, they will again, then now they decay fast and the second is gone. Now hot pressure is on the third one and it may not sustain that pressure and it may be quite damaged. So these things will help in making the balance in the system and condition monitoring of the system. So this one is one of the work which has been done. You can refer some papers from my website also on your battery management system and balancing of the system. This one is a second interesting thing, which is where we are more interested. This one is a very simple simple structure to make understand how your electric vehicle works. But for us, which is important is basically here is important is this part. This one is high voltage cable, which is present there. And now this one is drawing current at a different rates. So we have done some kind of analysis using some softwares. So this one is electrical stress basically. So you can see the electrical stress without load, and you can see here the with load. And very obvious the stress with load variations, that then the stress increases. You can see here, and it is coming to the boundaries. This one is electric stress. So we did various configuration and various structures. This one is another, the effect of temperature variation. So here the temperature on the cable, basically how it varies without load, and then how it is varying with load. So you can see, so why we are doing, how, where it will help us. These are NSYS basically. NSYS, you can take it. And there are various other software also. Because this will help us in understanding the safety of the persons who are there in the cable. Because if the cables are getting punctures, because you can see the stress is not uniform. Here it is more intense. Here it is less. So it will give us an idea that, okay, there are more chances of getting puncture of cable at this side and all that. So here you can devise some sensing unit with some kind of a transmitting unit, a transmitter, which sense and send and pass some kind of alarm and all these things to increase the safety of the cable basically. So that's another thing which you can check it, how the conductivity also varies with, because this one is very, very important. This we do normally in, normally also in electrical, that, okay, what is the effect on the conductivity, with and without load, what is the effect on the temperature, with and without load, what is the effect on the insulation with and without load. So these things has to be done. But here the problem is, since the on, off and braking and all these things and high pulsating conversion systems, so that's a very interesting area to understand. And the cables are of a different nature. So this one is another area where as currently we are working right now also. That, okay, can we develop some kind of mechanism which do the condition monitoring of my whole cable so that the driver and the people, they are basically, they are safe. And so this one is another thing which we have just performed. Another work which we are doing, and now it is, we are shifting to the, I think the third zone also, third zone of presentation. That is some areas, some research areas, which you can take it from here. One of my PhD students is working in this area. Just she submitted a thesis. A very interesting area that is like, okay, just imagine that we have n number of vehicles on the road, and then very obvious the charging system or charging units are not so much like we have petrol stations. Even on the petrol stations or gas stations in big cities, you will find it's very crowded. So the issue is basically how to go for manage charging management system, because we need recharging of the batteries. And if I'm talking about the charging station, oh, again, we have certain issues because you have battery, it takes some time to get charged, and that is one of the issue that, okay, how to get it one can say charged in a given limit of time. So there people suggested fast charging stations. Good. Fast charging means nothing but we increase the current level. I'm charging my battery at 10 ampere. I'll charge it at 300 ampere, so I get it charged fast. Fine. Some researchers, they indicated in their research articles, and it's very true that if you go by fast charging, it may damage your battery also. Another issue is on the grid side. If I have fast charging station, just imagine you have fast charging station and which is charging at say 300 ampere, and at a time that there are 10 vehicles, so it is a 3000 ampere, and it affects the grid and all those things are there. So that, those things are separate basically, but obviously we have limitation on the time and time of charging and all that. So yeah, many things comes in. One is consumer preference, basically. What is your preference? You go for a fast charging or you go for slow charging or something like that. Second is peak load of the system. Whether I'm charging at a peak load when my city is already under, my network is already under stress, already it is heavily loaded and at that time I'm charging. And then another one is charging over the space station, charging space at the station. So, see, you are moving and you know your charge is gone, it's going down and down. So, and then you reach to a particular charging station and you'll find that, okay, what is happening there? There's no charging space available, or there's no slot available. So, it is now it is again coming back to the some kind of, you know, system, basically. My battery, my vehicle is there. I have what kind of an app which is connected to the various charging stations. They show there what is the availability of the things, how much slots are available. My app also connect my connected to my car, which is also giving me how much charge is left, what is the nearest one, what is the slot available. All these things are there. And all these things need some kind of these IoT systems, basically. They need some kind of app mechanism. App is fitted with the real data, which is based upon the sensors which are being placed there. Like nobody is there at the charging station to give you the input that, okay, I have one slot left to stop. They have some kind of sensors, occupancy sensors. A vehicle is there that pass the signal to their system, and that system transmit it to all the users. So it's a nice application of what we are talking about IoT. And as a driver, I have that information, where the parking is available or charging space is available, where it is not available. So there is a communication basically between consumer, service provider and grid. And it's a both way side, means like a service provider pass the information to the consumers also, to the grid people also. It should not be like that, okay, service provider try to satisfy the consumer but at the same time it create a problem to the grid people. They will not allow you. So it's very interesting because the communication has to be bi-directional, it has to be very fast, and it contains various kind of sensors like occupancy sensor, my own car, and like I'm one user, lots of such users are already there. And then the grid people are already there that, okay, what is the current scenario of the grid or power available and all these things. So this one is a very interesting kind of a management problem. So this one is another area where IoT can be used and it can be taken by this research area. So then you schedule your charging, and then again you need real data. Basically consumers are here. So what is the quality of charging you are providing? It should not be very, say, nobody wants to get it charged, get it car charged with some kind of spiky signals, because if the signals are very, very spiky in nature, it damages their batteries. And let me share the biggest cost with the electrical vehicle is the battery, basically, right now. So they want like their battery to be on the safer side of charging system. And it should not be overcharge or undercharge and all these things. Obviously, time of scheduling is very important, because slot is given to you and you will reach after certain time, say 1 hour late. it is not there right now as such in developing countries, but in developed countries it is like it is there, because if you have given them a slot, then the time they reach there you have to provide a slot, otherwise you will be penalized. But you just imagine that the slot is given to you and you reach after 1 hour. So meanwhile, for 1 hour, they will lose some kind of revenue also. So it is penalty on you also. So it is something like a very complex kind of a structure which is building up with a lot of variability, and it has to be managed in a nice way. Okay, so we keep on because here now the money is also involved. Real time cost will be there. Very obvious if pricing is like the way it is coming into the grid. So the rates will also decide that when to charge my vehicle. Like already we have in petrol, we have per day prices, but similarly in your electricity sector, we also have pricing. And if it is flexible, then very obvious everybody wants to get it charged during the low price, and then everybody wants to jump to low price, that increase the demand, that increase the price. So it's a kind of a game between the price and the load and the consumers and the market. But for each and everything, that is very clear that we have to transmit the data in the form of my users and the consumers and the load requirement and the battery requirement. And for that, we need these small devices. There is another area which is very important, which is coming up, that is vehicle ad hoc network, basically. So there is a basically vehicle-to-vehicle wireless communication to increase the safety of the system, to make your driving system very nice. So it will control your traffic updates. It will control your road disasters if something happens. So we need basically onboard units which communicate to each other, basically. Also on the roadside also, if something mishap with somebody, so the information in straightforward reach to the stations. So there is a vehicle-to-vehicle communication. I have seen in some of the cases, some of the places they have vehicle-to-vehicle communication. So the speed is properly controlled and all those things are already monitored. And now when I'm talking vehicle-to-vehicle communication, then again, yes, I need small sensing units and some kind of a communication system which makes a basically IoT again. So it is vehicle-to-vehicle infrastructure also, like a traffic management, if I'm talking about automated traffic management. So right now it's not automated. We have lights basically which are static, which are faded, like okay, green for so much second, red for so much, and then they control it. What we are expecting is it should be automatic. If the traffic is someday it's increasing, automatically it increase and or decrease and accordingly to the requirement. So again, for that, we also need some kind of a sensors which count how many vehicles are going on, passing the information to another sensor, which is executing the time of various lights and then controlling the things in that particular way. So this is very important. V2 is everywhere. Vehicle to vehicle, one area. Vehicle to infrastructure, another area. Vehicle to network, another area. Vehicle to the device. Vehicle to pedestrian. Vehicle to grid. So V2, and the second part is a big variable. And everywhere we need different kind of sensors. And if these sensors are, they sense it basically, then the information has to be on the common platform. So that there we need, again, the transmission, conversion of the signal, and then the transmission of the signal. So that they are a common protocol and where they can be used in a very nice way to address the issues of future. Okay, so a few things are there. We need a storage keep on increasing because we are pumped with lot and lot of data. So that is one requirement, and we need a very high powered computing algorithms which can address these issues, because it's a kind of like big data. So we need big data calculations and optimization, all these things. But these things make your life comfortable and easy in a sense, because many things which are coming up. Hello, can you hear?
Yeah, yes, you are, please continue.
Okay, fine. So these are, we need a very high computing units, and these will help in some kind of moving into the depth of the system. That is basically understanding the system in advance, what is going to happen or why this type of things are happening and all these things. So this one is another application, basically what I'm talking about. So the sensors are then sense the traffic flow rate, they sense the volume, then effect of modification, they pass the controller section information, which makes the lights on and off. These sensors are mounted along the road. These sensors may be from vehicle to vehicle also, because the information is collected at a common platform. And then to manage the traffic flow, we don't need any kind of human requirement there. Machine learning algorithms or intelligent techniques people have already built, they can be used there to make it more and more automated with the different layer of security, very obvious. Because when you are working on the automated system and you are working with a communication system, you have to be very careful from security point of view. So if anybody can breach into your security, it will create some kind of a problem. So rerouting of the traffic and all these things can be possible because I have all this information on my system. So if something is happening, something is happening on a road at some place, so the information, because vehicle to vehicle are connected, it goes very fast rather than somebody phone somewhere and blah blah blah. It goes very fast, and then your algorithms take a decision and they divert the traffic also. So it brings one kind of easiness with the comfortable to the users, basically. So this one is one kind of another application. And now this one is more important. This one is very recent type of things. That is cyber physical system. Now CPS is there. You can say it's basically kind of a system where humans are also a part of it, basically. So not a controlling part, but in a different frame. But there is a great confusion, basically, between your CPS and IoT. So IoT, let's understand it. IoT is basically identifiable and internet connected devices. But CPS is the relation between the complex softwares and the hardware. You understand this part. Say and here comes that part also. Like I'm talking about the next version of it. There are other cars also nowadays. They are doing what they are doing is they have different sensors. Okay, so how many times you accelerated? A sensor is there, it gives store information. Then how many times you put up unnecessary brakes? That information is stored. How many times you pick your phone while driving? That information is stored. How many times you have done some extra activity while driving? Okay, how your car is adjusted? Car seat is adjusted. Have you put on a belt or not? All these informations are basically observed, and then they are processed using some kind of a complex software, and then they monitor your driving behavior, basically. So are you a rash driver or you're something else, which can be help in future also. Like if somebody is a very normal, very nice driver as per the specifications, but sometime happen, it may happen that at some instant his behavior is very, very totally different. So that may be an indication that something wrong happened to him health-wise. And it may raise an alarm to some kind of a mechanism which may help to save his life. So such type of things are coming in, and which is very interesting, where we can understand the human behaviors which are using these physical systems, basically. So this one is another very interesting area, that how and then we understand the effect, what is the effect of my driving pattern on my battery, basically. That's where, again, very interesting, that okay, if my driving pattern is like this, because people will understand then that in much better way, that okay, your battery is your battery is good for more time because your driving pattern is this much, and if your battery is not like it's deteriorating fast because your driving pattern is changing. So this one is like I'm just talking about the area related to EVs only, basically. So this one is a very interesting area and people are developing it. But again, for all these things, we need some sensors. And all those sensors must be powered with or having the facility of communication. That is basically transmit this data. And there is some kind of a unit, processing unit there itself, not at a certain developer, which can process these things. It can pass the data to a main server frame also, but very interesting part is it is there itself only. Like you have a very simple structure is if you are not putting your belt, immediately it gives you an alarm that okay, you are not putting your belt, please put it. It gives you some kind of a sign and all that. So some kind of those structures. So they those things make the things intelligent and more safe. Say if there is a phone call, your phone is connected to your system. Okay, so it will, no doubt, it will give you facility to talk to a second person without turning on your phone. You can use your car dashboard system to talk. But before that, if it give a warning, some kind of alarm to you that, okay, you are on a phone call, but you are also driving. So still you want to talk. Or it may give some kind of, say, you are driving at a very high speed, say 130 or 40, and there is a phone call, and if you want to take it, so it may be possible that it give you some alarm, and it may say that, okay, you can call it, you can talk to him, but reduce your speed to a safer zone or something like that. So those things which are expected in the coming generations, and some of the, one can say, higher-end vehicles, they have already incorporated such kind of things. So this one is another very interesting area where people are working. So this one is basically two types. So you can check it from here. You can understand much better with IoT means autonomous vehicle with V2V, V2I or V2N connection. Cyber-physical means autonomous vehicle with no connection outside vehicle. So I'm inside of my own is sufficient enough, basically. So I'm doing all kind of these things. So advanced version is the self-driving vehicle, but yeah, still people are still working on. But the rest of the things which are there inside it, what is the oxygen level in my vehicle? What is the comfort level of the driver? Whether and now it, I think you have seen some kind of application in the dragginess is the driver is driving for a long vehicle. Many time accident only happen because they slept. Between so the dizziness, the identification, the driver behavior, the driver comfort, and all these things. So that comes from the CPS. But yes, for also CPS, also you want to implement. So you can say it's a basically kind of a, you can take it now intra and inter IoT kind of stuff. So these are the few things which are very interesting that people are working on, and they are. Applying to various different domains. So I think that's a few, something from my side right now. I'll take some of the queries, and then if time we have certain time, so I'll take certain a few of the queries, and then we can discuss more on certain of the things. Some new applications also in between. So. Can I have questions on this one?
Can see Raj, from your side? Yeah. There are certain questions in the chat box.
Okay, so let me check my chat box.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I can see a few of them. I'm taking one by one. Oh, they are many. They are everyone discussing with each other.
Yes.
Okay, so. Okay, join me. Yeah, most of them are good morning.
So good morning to again to all.
Yeah, so the one question is how we implement sensor for the application of farming. The simplest one, simplest structure you which you can try is your humidity sensor. Okay, and it's an automated, if you want to develop a automated sprinkler system basically. So what we do is basically we put the humidity sensors at the different places at a right gap between them throughout the farm, across the farm, and then it keeps on sensing the humidity, and we have sprinkler system which is spread over. So what is happening there? This one is sensing the humidity, and if the humidity level is low, which is required, so reference you can set it. So if it is low, it will generate a signal which basically pump on the system, and the sprinkler system basically increase the humidity of that particular room. This one is one of the simplest application of basically the sensor and the IoT to be used for farming. If you are having one of my students is working on a greenhouse, basically there we have many challenges, because what we have to do is now because the cost is also there. So what we do is we put a humidity sensor, we put a thermal temperature sensors outside, we put airflow sensors, how the air is coming from one direction and flowing through the whole part, and then we use many different thermal temperature sensors to model the thermal profile inside a greenhouse. So that will affect, and then these sensors input are taken, and then we have to use it to control the temperature. So temperature can be controlled by airflow also, it can be controlled by sprinkling of water also, but it should not be like if I go for more sprinkling of water, the humidity goes very high, it may be dangerous for the crop. So I can use only sprinkling for to a particular level. Rest I control it through the airflow, so I can send some fresh air with certain kind of a temperature, and likewise. So these, there are lot of such kind of applications are there. Nowadays, another kind of you can have a application is you can have a robot which can basically detect the weed and take it away. So that is basically not directly as such to the means like no farming, but yes, it is the application which is used for farming. So what they do is they basically a robot is there, it take the images through camera, and there is a code which detect whether it's a weed or not. If it is weed, it take it out automatically and throw it away. So that is another kind of application. Then pesticides spray is another kind of application. So these are the, I mean, whatever we are doing there, if you want to automate it, we need a sensor, and we need some kind of a system where we can put your human brain to it. So if you are going to do that, then you need some kind of a communication and algorithm and machine learning kind of stuff. So that makes again an IoT application there. So that is, I think, I'm able to answer your query in this part.
Yes, okay? Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Rajesh. Okay. And there are a few questions regarding sensors more. If you can see, yeah, in the chat box.
Yeah, I'm coming to that. So one is working on RF energy harvesting. So if you are working on energy harvesting, so the question is, for what purpose you are doing energy harvesting? Radio frequency you are using energy harvesting for what purpose? So that is one. And then there are various modes of energy harvesting. Okay, and there are various mode of energy transfer also. So if you are transferring the energy, there are medical applications. Okay, nowadays they are approved by the medical councils, and now the product people are already using. One of the simplest product is basically you can say the pacemakers. So the pacemaker is put inside the body near the heart, and then they charge it externally basically. So that is basically an energy transfer basic kind of a mechanism. Harvesting, there are various ways to harvest the energy. So it varies like which application you want to do it. So and what purpose? Say, if I'm using an energy harvester and I want to implement it on a platform where there is a vibration, basically. So I can use some kind of piezoelectric energy harvester which keep on giving me two things simultaneously. Every time there is a vibration, it gives me energy to extract. Also, at the same time, it keep on giving me the amplitude. And if the amplitude is more than the limit, then it raises some kind of an alarm through a transfer mechanism that now the amplitude is increasing. It may be some kind of earthquake or something like that. There are a numerous number of applications which you can use it. So we have to see that what type, how you are harvesting the energy and what applications you are looking for. Because as such, we can say, we did it for some other purpose also. That was part of my research project when I was at NUS. That is basically we put wireless sensors throughout big jungles and forests basically. Just to detect the forest, not here, but abroad, fire in the forest is a very big issue. And those sensors, they keep on detecting the temperature and then they keep on sending to the base station. So if you are putting a sensor, to act it, we need power, basically. Otherwise, it will not work. So they are powered. And the question and the problem is there that if you power them, you need a battery. And they are just thrown just like that in the jungle. Okay, so you need a battery. And it's very difficult to change the battery after a certain time. So what they do is, initially they do it like that, and then we finally go for a energy harvesting. We put, instead of putting a battery only there, what you do is we have sensor, and we have a battery, and we have an energy harvesting mechanism also. So it keep on taking power from there also. So there are various applications you can use it for your purpose. Is all the wheels having individual motor? No, it totally depends upon the type of driving. So whether you are going for differential drive mechanism or not, so it depends upon the drive mechanism which you are using. Okay, and it is same like a robotics, basically electric vehicle. So what type of drive mechanism? Our cars, they don't have. You can see the most of our cars, they are not like all are engine powered. So only few wheels are powered and few are just supporting wheels. So that is the same here also in electric vehicle also. It depends upon how you are designing. It is not a good idea to put all the four motors or four tires unless until you make it a n-dimensional movement vehicle, which is not a requirement, because more motors you put on, it make it bulky. Okay, and there is no requirement of moving your car in n directions basically. So what we have is only normally we have front and back movement. So for that we have to see that okay, one motor is sufficient enough to control the wheels and all that. Risk factor of IoT devices is as such, they are very if I take over the devices as such, it's not very risky, because they work at a very low temperature, very low voltage and current, and they communicate. But so on the device side, it's not very risky, but on the other side, it is very risky. Risk in the sense is like they have communication, and if I communication window. So if I'm a good programmer or a hacker, I can enter into that, and then I can hack those things. Okay. So say simple device. I call it IoT. Your pacemaker is there. Okay. Pacemaker is there, in which is there placed just before the heart, and that pacemaker is used to pump your control the pumping of your heart. Okay, now this one is and at the same time wirelessly it is giving the information to you on your screen, also to the doctor there. Such type of pacemakers are already there. Now if you can hack to it, if you can enter into its communication system, and if you disturb the behavior of it, then it's very risky. So yes, you can take it in another way also. You can, if you have internet, you are the most safest. But if you have smartphones with all internet and everything, so you are more prone to those people, or you are exposed to those people who can enter into your system and create more problems. So that is one kind of a risk which is always there. So we have to go for security and security levels and all that. SOH is basically, I explained, that is state of health. Yeah, this one is there. Battery can be replaced by super capacitor. So your battery size increases, or you need high density batteries where you can store more power for a longer duration. Nothing like short power. We are saying that it's good for short because you are moving in a city, you will find that something which is very the charging stations and these things are very near to each other, so that's why it's always good. But yeah, you can go for a long drive, but then the size of the battery and the configuration of the drive vehicle also is good. Okay, I'm looking some more queries if they are there. Okay, you are, this one is an interesting question that is when it comes in terms of smart cities. So more focus on cleaning, maintaining and monitoring. So monitoring again now for all these three things, how to make the records or how to keep these things, how to make these things smart. Again, we need IoT system. Like monitoring, we need cameras. And then cameras being used, they keep on sending the streaming of your live motions to the base station, which has automated algorithm, which can detect what is happening, if something going wrong or not. Similarly, like cleaning also, you have like very simple example is there, like bins are there outside on the side of the road. So if it is full, there is a small sensor. If it is full, it send an indication or send a message to the cleaning people that the bin is full, take it away. And once they take it away, at the same time, it send information to the base system that yes, the bin is clean today or at this time, at this instant. So that makes, you know, like proper scheduling and maintaining of the things. So very. So these are the very interesting applications. Say we have done one kind of a project long back from my undergrad students. They did it. And it is, let me share with you. It's very interesting. Nowadays, it's like they have posted it on YouTube also, and then they got an innovation award for it. The idea is basically nothing but we put one sensor at the exit of your vehicle, and which can measure your NOx or COx emission. Okay. So it's not a very big deal to measure the carbon emission from your vehicle. And that sensor sense it, and then that signal, that amount is just transferred to the processing unit in the vehicle itself. That okay, this much is the emission, and it's fine. And then, as you say, if the service is not done, what will happen after certain time? The limit increases, and if it crosses, goes near to a threshold, it give a display on the small display unit which is placed there that your emission is increasing. It is near to the one kind of punishable limit. Still you are not doing it, again it increases, it gives further information that okay, the vehicle is having emission which is beyond the prescribed limit. Either you go do your service or it will be a problem for you. And if it is still continuing, then the next time it will not allow you to turn on your vehicle basically. So whatever you want to do, you can do it, but your vehicle will not turn on unless until some kind of like we have signed a security patch, and that will be issued only when you get your vehicle service properly. So that is basically IoT to make your things much good, beautiful, and kind of structures. So that is basically, and if it is vehicle is scheduled properly. Maintained properly. So every month that vehicle report, including the ID or engine chassis number and the carbon emission level, that is transmitted to the traffic pollution environment control of a particular city. So there is no need of getting this vehicle pollution check stickers and all these things on your screen and all that. It can be automatically done. So that's a nice application of your IoT. Just put a sensor and let the sensor to send the information regularly every month to the system, pollution control board. At the same time, it will also show you on your screen. So you are also aware of. So there is no need of giving a penalty, pollution check, dikhaiye. All things becomes very easy and more control. So there are lot of application of such type of things for smart cities. When you are talking about cleaning, maintenance, and monitoring of the things. So battery life can be, is there any mechanism to check it? So one way is you do various tests basically in the lab to check the health of your life of your battery, that is not a good idea. Reason being, because you perform certain tests, you charge, discharge, and draw some graphs. So that already take the health of your battery, because the battery is charged and discharged, and that. So what researchers now they are looking at, can we have some kind of a machine learning or AI based methods that can be used to detect the machine, to detect the life of a battery which is being used. So one of that which we have used is there itself. That is something like three-point kind of a structures. Parameters. So I predict those four parameters. So if they are exactly same, which I predict, okay, then my model is okay. I go for the next one. If there is a deviation, then I modify my model and then the predict. So it is something like now update and predict. It's a dynamic network model, which dynamic model which keep on modifying itself. So it's an auto-updated model which can be used. That is, I think, that is a much proper way, better way of using it. many electric come with their unique charger pin. Is there any invention like universal charger? Okay, that's basically how people sell the things. Apple has its own type of charger, different type. So that's basically business people, how they do it. Okay, how they sell the their own products. You take a Surface Pro, it has different charger. You take Mac, it has different charger. You take Dell laptop, it has different charger. So that's basically their way of doing the things, how they design their inside constructions. At the end, inside, there are the two points which take the electricity and send it further. So nothing like universal as such, but yeah, maybe sometime in future they come out because if you take those two points somehow outside, you can use any kind of charger for your purpose. Yeah, see, immunity sensors you are talking about, it can be there. Like, we have to understand, like, you know, what type of how my immunity is reflected, basically. One work we are working with bioinfo people is there, basically our blood, our sweat has some kind of information to some kind of immunity. So what we have to do is we have to take that measure that sweat, and from sweat we find out how much is the you can say chemical component, like your sulfur from there, those points calculations, we can, yes, then we can develop some kind of a mechanism, which is basically algorithm that, okay, if this value is this much, then this parameter is this much, and based on this one, we can say that your immunity is going down and up and likewise. So it's depending upon the immunity to related to what. And yes, I think in medicine, medical science, you will find such kind of things very soon. Earlier, you can say that now a diabetes test is in your hand, basically. Just one sensor is there. You take sample on it, and then, okay, there itself, you will get the information that, okay, how much is your diabetes. And if you, and not only there on the screen of that particular unit, but also if you connect it to your mobile, it keep a record of your sugar profiling. That, okay, on Monday, how much was your sugar? Tuesday, how much? Based upon that, it can suggest further you, okay, what to be done. And it will help the doctors also. It saves their time and make their recommendations more effective, because they have a complete profiling of it. Otherwise, it's very difficult. Every time you measure, record it, and then something is missed somewhere, then it could create a problem. So such type of things are already coming, and people are still working on this. Yeah, blockchain is something different. This one is basically, you can say it's one information is sent to the another end with some kind of few blocks. So those are security blocks, and they are connected to each other, so they make a chain. So that is basically more secure way of transferring the information, because they are connected in chain. If somebody play foul somewhere, then everybody knows that, basically, that, okay, the problem is created there. So it increases the security of the system. So there are security blocks, and it's a transfer. It then transfer the information or part from one point to the another part. So it's a chain of different blocks, and each block has certain kind of working. So it is connected to two, and then they are connected. All are connected. So if there is, you can say it's a more kind of a secure system. So, and it's a very interesting domain in computer science, where nowadays people are using it for various purposes. For electrical people, it is house is open, and people are trying to implement it in your electrical trading, basically. So that's another area where people can work on this one.